I hope to be able to help other people. And if by sharing this, if anybody is listening to what I am saying, I hope I can let them know that they're not alone. They don't have to go through this alone. And they can get out of it.
The last thing in the world you want to do is disappoint someone who looks at you that way. I wanted to be her hero. And yet here I was engaged in this behavior that was betraying her, that was disrespectful in my mind to women. And the last thing I wanted to do was let her know about that, because I thought, you know what? If she finds out the truth about this addiction, she could never love me.
The nature of what you're involved in is such that you don't want anybody to know about it. It's very shameful, and you feel dirty, and you're like, I don't want anybody to know about this. But one of the most powerful things to break in its control over you is actually just open up and talk about it.
More kids are looking at pornography than not. And I'm even speaking elementary school kids, and you know, junior high and high school and college and you know, on. But they're into it more than I see drug addiction or alcoholism. I mean, it is sweeping our country like a storm.
It is an addiction, and it's getting worse. It's a self-medication. The people that are coming into the clinic and seeing me over the last 10 years has dramatically increased.
It's affordable. Much of it's absolutely free. It's accessible. Don't have to sneak into the adult bookstore and hope none of your neighbors see you anymore. You just hit a button. And stuff that no one in the history of the world has ever seen is instantly there. So all that stands between me and my drug is a button. It's anonymous, and that's the big one, especially in religious and value-oriented communities. I wouldn't dare be seen staggering with a hangover or with needle marks in my arm. But now I can indulge in a drug that's just as powerful, and no one knows I'm doing it. It's anonymous. So I can keep up my outward appearance of propriety, but also enjoy this self-medication in secret. And then, of course, the last day is it's aggressive. The drug pushers come looking for us. Pornography pursues you. It comes up on your computer. They look to expose you. You don't even have to go seeking it. So accessible, anonymous, affordable, and aggressive. You apply those four A's to any other drug that you know of on earth, and you tell me what would happen to addiction rates. Skyrocket. And that's what we're seeing today.
I was 9 years old when I stumbled across pornography.
Brian, you have to come check this out.
Okay, just a sec. I must be this level.
Look right here.
Look. When a person is first exposed to pornography, they are usually shocked, but curiously aroused. It's like, oh, interesting. And it's that interest that kind of hooks them in. I mean, we're made to be attracted to nudity and to sexuality. It's built into our DNA. It's built into us biochemically. We get this rush of neurochemicals that just flood our bodies.
Boys, I'm home.
It was instantly enticing, and it was instantly, it struck something inside.
Hi, boys.
And there's a part of me that knew that, hey, this is bad. This can't be right. Yet at the same time, it was pleasurable. From that point on, it seems as if I would, you know, like any typical adolescent that grows up in America, I would stumble across it again. It'd be a magazine, a video.
At first, it seemed harmless, like it does with most people. But what I discovered quickly is that it started to get out of control.
Dinner's ready. Are you all right?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Okay, hurry up.
I didn't dare talk about any of those things with my parents. That was out of the question. because the response would have been very negative and very severe. So I kept it very much to myself. It was a very secretive, you know, private addiction, and just something that I, you know, went about in my own little secret world. A year before I got married, I had a pretty good handle on the addiction side. I decided I don't want to be a part of that anymore. It's disruptive, it's not congruent with who I am and what I value, and so I did a pretty good job staying away from it. We call it white knuckling.
You sort of convince yourself that, boy, when I get married, the habit will go away and things will work out and I'll be all right. I think I'd actually convince myself that maybe I'm kind of over this. Maybe this habit has been broken, finally.
For me, marriage was incredible. You know, I married my best friend. We were together all the time. Of course, the physical intimacy part was wonderful. And we just had a great relationship. And I was totally thrilled with marriage. And I thought, this is going to be fantastic for the rest of our lives.
The first several months was wonderful. I was a happy new bride and excited to show off my husband to my friends and family. And I thought, I was going to live happily ever after.
And as I said, things went well for quite a while. But then as the stress and pressures of, you know, being young marrieds and having work and school and children coming and all the financial pressures and keeping up good grades, and when all of that hit at once, you know, I had a nervous system and a brain that was trained that when you feel that kind of pressure, you turn to one drug of choice. It's called pornography. Shockingly, it came back and it was quite bewildering. I thought, how can this be? Well, I don't understand.
I found myself, you know, married, but when my wife would go off to work or she's off at school, I had a little time at home and I was alone, hey, I might go buy a magazine or go rent a video. And watch it and then get rid of it really fast, of course, and say, okay, I'm done. I'm washing my hands of this. You know, it's sort of this, I don't really want to do this, but I can't seem to help myself.
Most of them, it'll continue right into marriage, regardless of how well their sex life is or isn't. And that's a shocker to many of them. And then they will say, why is it that I do this when I have such a beautiful and wonderful wife? And I can't stop it, because they're addicted to the habit in the mind that they've established before they got married.
Well, a lot of people ask who don't struggle with pornography or haven't, why is this so powerful? I mean, why do people who get involved with pornography do such dumb things or worse, you know, horrible things? And as I studied with Dr. Paige Bailey over the years, we developed what we call the funnel of sexual process, and it looks like an hourglass. It's wide at the top, it goes narrow, there's a little narrow chamber, and then it goes wide again at the bottom. And if you look at sexual process, for example, if we talk about sexual process in a healthy marriage relationship, if a husband and wife express the intent that they want to be physically intimate with each other, and they come together to do that, as soon as they have that intent, their brain immediately begins to narrow its focus to go down into that funnel. And certain neurochemicals release, things like dopamine, which is the primary addiction chemical, by the way. It's the chemical that allows us to feel pleasure and satisfaction. Norepinephrine, an adrenaline derivative. Oxytocin, the great bonding chemical, you know, that bonds a mother to a newborn child, bonds couples together. If you take that funnel out of that marriage relationship and you move it over to pornography process, the chemical release is identical to what took place in the marriage. And so pornography mimics or counterfeits the process that one experiences with sexual intimacy. When someone's viewing pornography, the brain believes that it's having an actual physical sexual encounter. It can't tell the difference. So the same chemicals are flooding the system, the same narrowing is taking place, and so the whole world is being shut out. And all I'm focusing on are those images and that experience. Nothing else exists for me. We know that dopamine literally detaches the frontal lobes, and the pleasure center of the brain, the limbic system, is in the driver's seat. So there's no logic, there's no reason, there's no thought of goals or consequences or my wife or God. None of that exists. It's all being closed off. And so when that crescendo event happens with pornography viewing, which it always does, and the individual emerges from that narrow place, the chemicals dissipate, the frontal lobes are reconnecting. Now all of a sudden, all of the perspective returns. And it's, oh my gosh, what have I done? What was I thinking? Of course, the response to the question, what was I thinking, is you weren't. You couldn't. In that narrow place, you're not thinking. And then the regret, the shame, the guilt, the remorse, all of that kicks in, and the depression, and the self-flogging. And what that does is it eventually causes the person in that pain to go right back into the top of the funnel and to start the process all over again.
Then it began to get very scary. And I knew I was starting to fall, and things were getting out of control.
The thing with addiction is you're so desperate to not be found out because the consequences are unthinkable that it can become quite elaborate. I mean, a great deal of an addiction can be spent just going through the rituals to stay in secret so that you're not found out.
It's really difficult to find outward signs. The reason is because it's so private, so secretive. It's staying late at work. It's getting up at night. It's spending excessive time on the computer. It's a drop in self-esteem and confidence. People can become irritable. They lose ambition. It just goes right to a person's core and just rips it apart.
There was no dramatic change. Things happened little by little, moment by moment. We had only been married 6 or 7 months when I thought we were doing everything the same as we always had, and my husband became angry all of a sudden.
Hey!
Scared me.
What's that?
This is nothing. It's just a project I gotta do for work.
Well, can I see it?
Look, it's nothing. It's just a report. How was your day?
Tom, can we talk?
Look, Sarah, I'm really tired. I just want to go to bed.
Something the matter, Tom?
Like what? I thought you trusted me.
From then on, I started thinking, what did I do?
I didn't even realize what was being done to me, the effect that porn was having on me. But I think other people around me would, if they were to evaluate me and what I was like back then as I related to them, they'd say, yeah, you were distant. You were here, but you weren't really here.
There was something missing. Like, I felt like he wasn't really connected emotionally to me. And so I kind of focused just more on myself and figured, you know, he'll work out whatever's going on. And I didn't really realize that there could be something so serious. I was really upset and hurt, and I think probably one of the hardest things about finding out you have a husband that has a sexual addiction is the dishonesty.
I was surprised at the beginning. When I approached him about it, and he knew that he couldn't hide it from me anymore, he became angry and turned it around to make me think it was my fault.
Hey, dear. What's the matter? Where'd you get that?
I found it in your dresser, Tom.
Look, Sarah, it's not that big of a deal. You know, if our sex life was a little more interesting, I wouldn't have to look at that. What? I told you it's not that big of a deal. People look at this stuff all the time.
Tom!
Look, Sarah,
I want this stuff out of our house.
Look, I don't want to talk about it anymore, all right?
I had tried so hard. I mean, I just put forth a mammoth effort, and then I would fail anyway. And it just makes an individual feel so worthless and discouraged. You know, what's wrong with me? I must be the weakest person on earth, because everyone keeps telling me, you're just not trying hard enough. If you really wanted to overcome this, you would. And I knew I really wanted to overcome this. I did, desperately. And yet I would keep falling back into it.
As his sexual addictions became stronger from his pornography addictions, I was basically forced to have sex with him. Not once, not twice, sometimes three times a day. And he would use tactics to get me to give in. He would belittle me, tell me what a bad person I was, if my children only knew what kind of a person I was. He would punch holes in the wall right next to my head, and he'd say, wouldn't you rather I punched the wall than to punch you?
What happens is you really develop two things. One is what we call the control and release phase. And so when you're in the control phase, and think of it as two circles. So the control phase is a circle, and if I'm winding around in the control phase, I'm trying to do everything right. I'm trying to be the perfect father, the perfect husband, the perfect religious person. I'm trying to do great in my job, trying to behave perfectly, and trying to be approved by everyone. I mean, I want to be the perfect man. And I'm trying desperately to do that. I'm trying to control my life. Not only do you try to control your own life and be perfect, but you try to make everyone around you be perfect. And you basically become a tyrant, where your expectations are unreasonable. The level that you expect yourself and everyone else to attain to, it's off the charts. And it makes yourself and everyone else miserable. And then when you finally can't keep it up anymore and you escape into the release phase and act out your addiction, your whole personality changes. You isolate, you go into secrecy, you become moody and depressed and angry. And then the people around you think, what is the matter with this guy? It's Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. It seems like two entirely separate people. You know, and even my wife would say, I don't think I know you. You're this and then you're that. Who are you? And when you're in the addiction, you literally feel that way. You don't know who you are.
My daughters and I went to a friend's house one evening to watch a video and to do each other's nails. And we hadn't been there 10 minutes when my husband came knocking at the door. And he said, are you going to stay here and play, or are you going to come home and be a wife to me? And I left everybody having fun. And I went home like a whipped puppy with his tail between his legs.
For a spouse, they have to begin to protect themselves, begin to build up some sort of, you know, protective coating for their own hearts and their own souls.
I want you and all of your magazines and videos out of this house by tomorrow, or I am calling the police.
We went to therapy and counseling over 17 years of our 25-year marriage, and nothing was getting better. It seemed to just keep getting worse and worse and worse. That's when it hit me. I said to myself, who am I protecting? My children or my husband? And that was when we packed up and we were out of there within a week.
For me, because of the nature of the acting out and the years and the whole dynamics of everything,
I just knew I could not go back to him.
And that's sort of when I threw my hands up and said, okay, I will do whatever it takes. I don't care anymore. What do I have to do? And it was always this, and for me, it was God whispering ever so quietly to me, tell someone, talk about it. And I finally, in that moment, got up enough courage to call a friend. And I just got on the phone and I said, can you come over? Because I have got to talk to somebody. I want to talk to you. Because this was a very close friend, a very dear friend. And I sat there and we sat in the living room of my home. And I, for the first time ever confessed and spoke the words with my mouth that I struggle with pornography. And I'm essentially addicted to pornography.
My minister was the person I felt the least threatened by. I thought probably he could understand at least a little bit. And so the closest I could come to telling him was I was at church and I had picked up a book on addiction. And one of the chapters in that book was about pornography. And so I had yellow highlighted all the places in that chapter about pornography. And I took the book, I handed it to him, and I said, take a look at the marked section, and then I want to talk to you. So he took the book, and he went away, and I didn't hear from him for about 2 weeks. And he called, and he said, okay, I've looked at the places in your book. Why don't you come and see me? So I remember the night I went over to his office, and I walked to the door, and he had the book sitting on his desk, and he had this really serious look on his face. And I thought, I knew it. I'm dead. He's lost all respect for me. He's angry. He's going to read me the riot act. So he looked at me and he said, how did you find out? And I looked at him. I said, how did I find out what? He said, well, you gave me this book with all these sections marked about pornography use. How did you find out that I had a pornography problem years ago? And of course, my mouth hit the floor and I looked at him and I said, I didn't give that to you for your pornography problem. I gave it to you for mine. And we had one of these nervous laughs together, you know. And the amazing thing is I came out of that meeting and two things occurred to me that had never occurred before. First of all, I didn't think less of him or respect him less after finding out about his challenge in years past. My love and respect for him actually grew by leaps and bounds. And I thought, if I feel that way about him, knowing now about his past, maybe he could feel that same way about me, knowing what he does.
So tell me, what is it I can help you with?
Well, I just you see, my wife and I,
that's okay, take your time.
I'm addicted to pornography.
In that instant, as I disclosed this deep, dark secret, for the first time ever, there was an enormous weight lifted. You know, it was like instant, like freedom almost, and the pressure was off.
People often ask, can I just get over this by myself? And one of the things I said for years was, God and I will get through this just fine. Now, the reason I said that God and I could get through it is because if God and I were working on it, that meant I didn't have to tell anyone else. And so I didn't have to go through the shame and the disclosure. And that's the reason why most people caught up in this keep it a secret. It's not because they really believe that they can get through it alone. It's just that the alternative of telling others is so frightening that they just try to go it alone. Well, it doesn't work because one of the drivers for this addiction is shame. This is a shame-based addiction. So if you're so shameful that you can't share with others about your struggle, then you can't possibly hope to overcome this because the shame is going to continually fuel it. the more shameful I feel, the more hollow I feel inside, and the more need I feel to go and escape with my drug, right? So you've seeking help is part of the step of getting rid of the shame, which is the only way to start to get through this addiction.
Ultimately, you need help. You will not break free from an addiction to pornography by yourself. And whether you go with a counselor or you go with a spiritual leader, you're going to have some assistance, some help, some people to guide you through the process of getting breaking free from it.
Hello?
It's me. I went to a therapist today. Yeah, I was wondering if, I was wondering if you'd be willing to help me get through this.
Yes.
Thank you.
It was very refreshing when he came forward and decided that he was going to be completely honest. Because even though some of the things were really hard for me to face and, you know, and most people would run from, it gave me hope. And I had hope, not just for a relationship, but I had hope for him as a person.
I love you, son. Just tell me what you've done. Life's full of problems. Together we can solve them. Talk it out with me. Work it out, you'll see. I love you, son.
That was certainly not an ending place for the addiction. That was really a starting place. I mean, that was a start of a journey for the two of us, you know, to work through this. Just because you tell someone doesn't mean that this is going to go away. I mean, you have to realize that you have spent years and thousands of repetitions building a circuitry in your brain that behaves in this way. You've built an addiction circuitry. And what takes years and thousands of repetitions to develop doesn't go away overnight.
Part of the journey for me has been to confess to my wife and to ask for forgiveness and to rebuild trust, because a deep trust has been broken. So whereas I'm extremely exhilarated, I'm happy to be free from this thing, my wife is sort of back over here going, well, I'm still hurting here.
Even though it's their problem and you have nothing to do with it and it is not your fault, that you are affected by it greatly, and your family and your children, and you need to get the help you need so that you can move forward and find the joy and the hope and that you need.
But if you find yourself getting farther and farther away and realizing that the addiction is controlling him, he's not controlling the addiction, then there's a time to stop and start taking care of yourself.
As tough as a sexual addiction is, man, I'll tell you what, you can get through it. You know, in the old adage, once an addict, always an addict? What a load of garbage that is. Because your brain is made to change and evolve and develop. And you may have been a sexual addict at one time, but given time, that can change.
You will not get free alone. If indeed you recognize that you are in a dark place and things are out of control and you want to be free, it won't go away, it won't wear off. You will have to have help. It will demand something of you. It ain't going to be easy. It will not be easy. I promise it won't be easy. But it's either, you can either choose life or you can choose survival.
We can't always control the outcome with others. So I want to give anybody hope, whether, you know, they end up staying married or not. But you can control what you do. And so get the help that you need, and there's so much help out there for spouses. And you'll make some of the best friends you ever had. Which might be hard to think about when you're just wallowing in this pain, because it is hard. But there's great benefits that will come.
It has made me stronger. I know my worth now. But as I look back and see what we've been through, what we've had to go through to get to where we are today, we're still going through the healing process. We're still working on things 6 years later. But we are so much, so much in a better place now. And I am very grateful for those words of wisdom that somebody cared about me to tell me. It's not too late to mirror a healthier way to live to your children.
You're never going to know how people are going to respond unless you give them a chance. And so I would say take the risk, because it's worth it. You've tried to do this by yourself how many times? Thousands? Well, I can overcome this anytime I want. Well, how many times do we hear smokers say that? Oh yeah, I can quit anytime I want. Well, if you could have, you would have. And so the answer is, none of us, really, we're not designed to get along in this life by ourselves. All of us face challenges, all of us face weaknesses, all of us face barriers. We need to rely on each other. You know, people need people. And we don't do ourselves a service when we isolate and keep ourselves from others. So there's only hope. This is all about hope. And if someone is struggling with pornography addiction, I say, awesome. You are going to have the experience of your life coming out of this. You're going to be so incredibly happy, and you're going to feel like you've really accomplished something amazing.
I love you, son. Just tell me what you've done. Life's full of problems. Together we can solve them. Talk it out with me. Work it out, you'll see. I love you, son. 36, what could have been, was in an awful mess. Broken dreams, a broken home, broken promises. So from the valley of his dark despair rose a first attempted prayer. He said, oh Lord, I know you hate me. Then in disbelief he heard the Father say, I love you, son. Just tell me what you've done. Life's full of problems. Together we can solve them. Talk it out with me. We'll work it out, you'll see. I love you, son.